So I take care of lots of addicted individuals or formerly addicted individuals, and there's usually this epiphany where you hit rock bottom, and it's often financially. You're on the street, you've lost everything. When I read your book, you kind of did this. You didn't have that sort of rock bottom epiphany. One of the things that struck me, you had taken a video camera down to South America. And as I recall, you were watching your friends kind of through the lens of the camera, and were just kind of appalled at actually seeing what you and your friends had become. Was that a big turning point in your life?
Yeah, it was a moment of clarity. And I think, you know, in some ways I hit bottom at the top, right? I hit bottom in a compound with the beautiful people. And I remember one guy with us was gambling $10,000 hands of blackjack. And like, he just didn't care if he won or lost, right? So it was almost this veil that was lifted that I realized there would never be enough. Somebody would always have a more beautiful girlfriend. Somebody would always have a better watch, a better car, better status, you know, a private plane. And that this pursuit would lead to, you know, even deeper and deeper unhappiness. And there was something about, you know, having the camera as that shield between me. You know, there was a moment where someone was like, yo, film this. And I'm like, what's this? It's just a bunch of drugged out people. Like, there's no this, there's no there. You know, like, this is amazing. Like, what's amazing? I think, and this might help, you know, people that are struggling with addiction, you know, or might have some failed attempts of getting out of that. You know, for me, the environment mattered so much. I mean, I changed environment. So I went from a bunch of people doing drugs and partying to a bunch of like Christian humanitarian doctors who had forsaken their vacation time to, you know, live out their faith and operate on the poor. So nobody was smoking. Nobody was drinking. People went to bed at 10 o'clock at night and got up at 5. So the environment changed, and it felt right to me. It felt healthy. It was wholesome. It was a place of compassion and grace and service. So I saw a lot of stuff, and I talk about some of this in the book, but the one thing that just stuck with me was when I saw people drink dirty water. When I went into the villages and saw that children were drinking from swamps and from ponds and from rivers, brown, viscous, chocolate milk-looking sludge, you know, ponds filled with algae and bugs actually crawling on the surface of the water, but yet this is all that they had. And I learned that these weren't isolated villages. 50% of the country was drinking bad water. So half the people in the country where we were bringing doctors into didn't have the most basic need for health met.
I think you watched a little girl who was, you know, her clothes were brown because everything was washed in brown water. And you, as I recall, you watched this little girl drinking some of this brown water, and she immediately vomits it up.
Yeah, imagine seeing that. Imagine seeing a child forced to drink from a river because of the condition she was born into. She, by no fault of hers, but yet that's the only available water. And then watch a child drink this and then vomit on her shirt. You know, it was horror what we were seeing. And I learned that 52% of the disease throughout the developing world, or what some people might call the third world, half of that disease was directly caused by unsafe water, a lack of sanitation, a lack of hygiene. So, you know, if I really cared about health, instead of maybe funding another $50 or $60 million hospital ship, what if I went and just tried to provide people with the basic need? What if I tried to go into that country and help the 50% of people drinking contaminated water get clean water to drink? And to me, you know, this was the question behind the question. It was the root cause that I had stumbled into. And I didn't have to be that smart to put it together. You know, thousands of sick people, 50% of people drinking bad water. So I came back to New York at 30, and this was going to be my mission, was going to be to improve people's lives, to end extreme poverty by helping the world, everyone in the world, get clean water to drink. And at the time, there were 1 billion people living without it. So it was 1 in 6 humans alive 12 years ago that didn't have clean water to drink. And I'm like, well, we got to start somewhere. So let's just start.